Welcome to today's lecture. It's titled Examining the Arithmetic Mind of J.S. Bach. And this is the first lecture in the new GI series, lecture series.
Woo!
Yeah, so. Here at the GI Council, we strive to make a better St. John's for everyone. I just want to thank the GI Council and also the faculty and staff at St. John's, because everybody's been working together to make this happen, and it's pretty exciting for everybody, and I'm particularly excited. I've been working on this lecture more or less for about 10 years or so, and this is, I think, the first time really that I'm taking a stab at presenting it. So if you have any questions as I'm going, please just raise your hand. If I can't answer the question right away, I will just save it for the end. I'm going to try to have a Q&A at the end. And don't be intimidated by all the detail or all the technical stuff. I'm going to throw a bunch of language at you, but I'm only trying to get an idea across, and I'm not really trying to teach this to you. So, so along that line, if you're wondering what to pay attention to, try to get pay attention to the idea more than following along the specifics. And that'll probably make it easier to follow, because it's still unclear to me, too. So we're kind of together on this, all right? And I think that's probably everything. So what I wanted to do today, it's called Examining the Arithmetic Mind of Bach. And I took that from Glenn Gould, who mentioned the word arithmetic when describing Bach. And what I'm really talking about is using the patterns in the scale, and also using this common notion about how we hear sound in groupings, to try to look at individual groupings and examine what is contained within them, and then to take that information and apply it to the scale, and use it musical conventions to try to bring everything together. And what I've been finding about Bach is that there's always a very concrete and logical process that seems to be drawn out of the patterns that are in the scale. So this is the melody right here. You probably have heard it before. I'll play it for you. It's taken from, it's just an excerpt from Fugue in C minor from the Well-Tempered Clavier. It's the first book. It goes like this. And that's as much as I'm going to examine. And what I'm going to ask you to listen for is the individual groupings of sounds, this being the first one, and this being the second one, and then this just being a repetition. Come on in. And then here's another grouping, and I'm just going to go through it like this. There's a grouping of three, a grouping of three, and I want to look at how these groupings are formed and how they relate to each other and how new groupings are formed by them. So first, I'm going to try to do a quick overview of some common notions about how we hear sounds. So the first one is that we hear sounds in groups. And what that means is if these represent sounds, that's a group, this might be a group, that might be a group, that might be a group. And you can hear that if I do something like this. Separated, I think. And so you get an image of what you might be hearing. And so that's the first common notion, is that we hear sound in groups. And to that, you can say that they have numbers. Like I was saying, you can, there's three, there's four, there's a combination of two notes, but there's three rhythms. And so what that means is that even though we hear groups, we can hear different levels of numbers in them. The second common notion is that groups are formed according to association or disassociation principles. And so I have them listed here. The first one is their groups are formed if they have proximity in time. So if this is a series of notes, this is time, this is what the melodic line is going to be. And that might sound something like this. The second rule is the proximity in space. And what that means is that this note and that note are close to each other in space, closer to one another than these two. And these two are closer to each other than these other two. So that is sort of like, you have this in time, but you have this in space. And so at two different levels, you have two different melodic forms happening. And what happens when we're hearing the music is we're processing it, I suppose, at all of these different levels. And it's just something to think about, whether it's these different aspects that are overlapping that is making the sound so integrated. The third is, and I'm still trying to work this one out, but it has to do with according to beat. So if you have maybe a pattern of a strong, a weak, and then a strong, a weak, and a weak, which you probably know from marches. If you have the first beat will form a melodic association with the first beat. So maybe something like this. And you can hear that. So, and then, and then the fourth one is that melodic associations will form in what I call beat hierarchy, and what that all that really means is that you have weak beats and you have strong beats, and so let's say you have a strong beat, a weak beat, and a strong beat. If these two weak beats are closer in time and in space to this one, it's likely the weak beat is going to attach to the strong beat. And if it's closer rhythmically to the first note than to the first strong beat, then it'll probably attach to that. And I can give you an example. First, I'll establish a rhythmic context, and then I'll show you how this note can be attached to there, or it can be attached to there. Because this rhythm was closer to there, but if I reverse that, I can do it this way. And you can hear just the subtle differences that cause the different associations. And so it says groups contain information and can be expressed arithmetically. So then the next common notion is that melody is embodied in scale. So getting back to Johann Sebastian Bach, when he plays something like that is happening within the context of a scale. And so there's going to be imitation in it. So he might do. And so one of the pieces of information that you get from a melodic grouping is where in the scale it occurs. And so the next common notion. So that was the first group of common notions having to do with how we hear sound. The second group of common notions has to do with imitation. And I'm taking a little bit from Aristotle's Poetics. He's A is to B, as C is to D. And I'm also thinking about a music theorist by the name of Henrik Schenker. And in some of his unpublished essays, he proposed that the beginnings of music as its own art form happened when composers started turning their attention inward and thinking about the relationships within the sounds, imitation within the sounds. And then going on to the next common notion is the idea that, I think it's maybe a 20th century concept. It's the idea of where does identity come from? And specifically, if we have something like a scale, like a C major scale, what's the thing that makes it the major scale versus some other type of scale? And the first option is to say the scale is defined by the notes that it contains. In this case, it's C, D, E, F, G, A, B, and C. But the problem there is if you accepted that definition, this would be a completely different scale from this because they use different notes. And obviously, you'd have to set aside the fact that it sounds exactly the same, just a little bit higher. And so the conclusion is that really what's important in the identity of a grouping of sounds is the unit of measurement that we hear, the distance in sound that we hear from one sound to the next. And so when you say a scale is defined by a formula, maybe this is a whole step, a half step, and so on, you can say that is the identity of the scale. So you can take that further and you can say, well, what makes a melody, what gives it its identity? And you can say, well, it's the formula of one note to the other, whether it's going up or down. Example, I could repeat that, and you can recognize it's the same thing. I can also play up here, you can still recognize it. But what happens if I do this? There's something not quite the same, and the thing that you might be hearing is that this is a half step. And the formula for the song is two whole steps. And so these are really important aspects to how we hear sound and how we think about it. And it's also important in how we understand music and how we talk about it and discuss it. Because traditionally, we would understand a piece of music by its formal structure. Just in the way you might understand that a play has three acts and that each act has scenes, or that a piece of writing has sentences. You might say that a piece of music has a phrase and that the phrases follow certain orderings, and you can give a structure. It's a sonata form or it's a popular form. And but according to these common notions, there's something deeper to consider, which is the character and formula of the melody. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the board over. We'll get back to this. Because what I want to show you is, here I have an image. If we're considering that the scale is comprised of whole steps and half steps, and that's what it is, by the fact that it's the formula that defines it, then we're at a very interesting situation because, for one, you can see on the piano, it doesn't just go one octave. There's a note above C, and there's notes below it, and so you have this whole span. So rather than representing the scale as a formula like this, it's better to represent it like a circle. And then once you do that, you can start to realize that the scale actually isn't just one pattern, but it actually consists of internal patterns. And if we go to the common notion that it's those individual patterns that gives it its identity, we have to ask, are we really understanding the scale in the proper way? Because here I've taken this pattern and I found all of the patterns within it, or represented some of the main patterns that have their own individuality as a pattern, which makes them their own thing. And here I have all of the whole steps. There's five of them. There's this one, that one, this one, this one, that one. And I have patterns of whole half steps, which are just right here and right here. There are patterns of two whole steps, which are like this. Here's a whole step and a whole step. And that grouping can be placed at different locations in the scale. And so what it gets down to is I decided that it makes more sense to take the scale and think of this pattern as the union of all of the internal pattern formulas that exist within it. And since they all have an individual identity, we can see that there's an intimacy that we can form about the patterns in the scale and how it can be used as a paradigm for understanding imitative music, such as Bach's. And so what I have here are just some images. These are all the same formula, but what I've done is I've taken the internal groupings. Here's a grouping of three. If you look at these individual blocks, you have C, D, and E, and that formula is a whole step and a whole step. I put that right here. And you can see that these groups can be placed in different ways. In this first one, these three groups are placed right next to each other and they're separated by a half step. So that is sort of like this. In the second one, because this F, because the octave is spanning in both directions, you can take the F above or you can take the F below, which means that these groups can be on either side of this group. And if you do that, there's going to be a space here, so it might look more like this. Here's the first group of three. There's a group of three here with a note in between, and then there's another group of three here with a note in between. And then the third one is that they might be overlapping. And if you're wondering why this might be important, well, I can show you. The idea was that Bach writes within these individual structures, and so each one and how it's parsed out is going to lead to a different type of phrasing. So if I take this first group that has them parsed next to each other, I might be able to do something like this. But if I do something like this where they're separated, then it's going to sound a little bit different. I might do something like this.
The conventional
forms and processes by looking at how this individual type can be combined with itself to create harmony and movement. So something like these half steps, there might be a phrase that Bach would do like this. And you hear that in one of his famous pieces of the Prelude in C major.
Thank you.
start to create harmony, and it brings the integration of all of the conventions that we're accustomed to searching for in his music. But as far as I can see, those conventions arise naturally when you identify individual homogeneous structures within the scale and combine them to create harmony. And so I'm looking at all these, and I'm not going to go through them all, but what I notice is, how do we define the scale? This one, you have a grouping of six. You have all the way from here to there. This is the largest pattern in the scale that can be repeated. And I put it here to show from G to E is a whole step, half step, whole step, whole step. And that's the same formula from C to A. And so it can overlap on itself. And so what that means is that anything, any music of all, any combination of sounds that happen within this span has imitation down there. Or it can be imitated up here. But it has to work within this limit. So if I play this, I can repeat that. But if I go beyond those notes, and by playing that half step, I've exceeded the limitation of that repeatability. You can see that. So what's happening in Bach's music is he's finding a scale with the limitation of it, and then he's working with the individuality of that. Of that internal scale. And so with that in mind, I'm going to turn the board back over, and I'm just going to cover one more, I'm going to cover the next concept, which is the idea of proportions and complements. So here I have an image of a line, and it really has no more significance than it's just a line, and you can think of it as a whole of something. And I put a line of symmetry. Well, come on in.
This isn't the meeting I meant to be attending.
I think there's another meeting. So here's a line, and you have a line of symmetry right down the middle. And so what I did is I just represented it with percentages. If you put a dot over the line of symmetry, you can consider it like a 60-40 division. And the thing that's interesting about that is, if you consider 60, you say that 40 is the complement, because together they add up to the whole. And since it's a line of symmetry, you can flip this point around the line of symmetry, and so you can put the 40 on the bottom and the 60 on top. But you can actually do one more thing, because this point forms a relationship with this point and with this both outer points, and so does this one. And so what that means is you can look at it from the inverse way and say this point forms a 40 and a 60 relationship with each of those tones, and this point also forms a 40 and 60 relationship. And what this corresponds to in the scale is if you take the octave, the C and the C, like here, then you consider this is C and this is C, this line of symmetry would be the F sharp. And then you have a G, which would be your 60, which would create a 60-40 proportions. And what that means is that if this is G, you have a, quote, 60 relationship with C, and you also have a 40 relationship with C. So whatever I said here can now transfer to G, and I can also flip that point around, the point of symmetry, which means that I can use F. Because you see, the F sharp is the point of symmetry, so the G is on one side and the F is on the other. And what that means is that if I have an octave and I have a G, then I'm going to have one interval on the bottom and what's called the complement interval on top. And I can flip that around. I can put the fifth on the bottom and the fourth on the top, the fourth on the bottom, and the fifth appears on the top. And it also means that from a given note, I can form a relationship, a fourth and a fifth, or a fourth. So this is going to become important in our analysis of Bach. Now, I think probably the next thing to do is to look at the idea of grouping. And as I said in the Common Notions, that we're hearing sounds in groupings. And so I wanted to look at the different ways that groupings can be related to each other to generate new groupings. So let's say I have a grouping of two. Let's say I have a grouping of two. yeah, grooving over itself. And because I've repeated it, I have 2 + 2 = 4. And what that means is I can repeat that grouping and maybe do this. And I can use those groupings of 4 because I already generated by repeating the grouping of 2. The second one is I can take the grouping of 2 and make them overlap so that we have 0 tones in common. So if I do something like this, then what's happening is now I'm still using a grouping of 2, but I also have, now I've created 2 new tones. So now I have 4 tones. So I can do this, and it's going to be acceptable to our ears because the information was already presented to us on some very subtle level. And then it goes on where they can have overlap like this. And the same concept applies, basically. The idea is that any grouping is going to contain an arithmetic within it you can assign numbers to. This simplifies it. In truth, and I don't even know if this is everything, in a grouping, you can identify what is the interval, which is the half step. You can identify, and so that, I would say, the number is a half step. You can say, what is the rhythm? I have 2 notes, which is a half step, but I could also do... So while I have the number 2, I also have the number 3 in the rhythm. And if I have one note that's accented, like, then I have the number 1, which is the accented note, the number 2, which is the number of tones that are being used, and the number 3, which is the rhythms that are happening. And then I even have another number, which has to do with the implied duration of the beat. And so these are all information that you can look at. And the most important one for imitation is the interval that's being used, because the interval will tell you where you can imitate in the scale. And so, let me see if I've gone over anything. Are there any like cursory like questions right now? Anybody have anything you want to ask? Okay. So basically, what I went through is basic common notions of how we hear sound and how we form groupings. And the idea that the groupings contain information about the scale and also information about the arithmetic of what we're hearing, and that we can form those groupings and use them to generate new information. And that doing this, we are embodying the notion that the identity of the piece is in its internal components and its internal structures. So now what I want to do is go back to this melody that Bach wrote. And what I did here is I put into some groupings. So I'm just going to walk you through, because I want to leave time for some questions, so I'm just going to go really quickly through this, and then you can ask questions. So the first grouping, I'm just going to represent it like this. And what we have here is a half step. And what I'm going to show, the idea is you take information in the first group, you take some aspect of it, and you relate it, and you generate something new from it. So first he uses a half step, and then what he follows it with is another half step, like that. And this black represents the stressed tone, and the white represents the unstressed tones. And so you see there's the number 1 for the stressed, the number 2 for the number of tones, and the number 3 for the amount of information that you have. So first he does this, and then he does that. And that sounds like this. And what I wanted to point out is that if you take the stress tone and the stress tone and you combine them, it creates a consonant interval, which is a third. So the analysis of the piece has to do with complements, what we talked about with complements. The complement of a third is a sixth. So if this is a third, this is a sixth. And what he's doing in this piece is you can think of it like a proposition in geometry, a construction proposition. Proposition is to construct motion from a third to its complement, a sixth. What he's doing in the piece is he's emphasizing this interval, and then he's traveling down to that interval, and he's moving through consonant intervals as he does it. He goes from here to there, to there. is by using smaller units that are in common. So you have the grouping, the identity structure of a half step, which is here and here, and you have here and here. These are both half steps. And what they have with the A flat and the C is common to the group of half steps and but it's also common to the interval of a third. And so he establishes this third by taking the strum beat in both of these groupings. And also I want to point out that if you were to play this pattern and this pattern at the same time, you get this nice counterpoint. And so what's really going on is that the melody is revealing actually a deeper structure. If the structure is this motion, the melody is just there to expose it. And so first he has this grouping, and then he forms that grouping. Now, it says here, the first grouping has information, the second grouping is derived from the first grouping, and the result is a third grouping, which I just showed you. And then, the next thing happens is that an ungrouped, so what that means is, this is a grouping here, and this is a grouping here. But going back to the idea of imitation, or excuse me, the idea of time, melodic formations occur in time. Well, this note is attached to this grouping, and this note is attached to this grouping. So these two notes are ungrouped. It's this note to that note. You don't necessarily hear that as a grouping. And so, but the next thing he does is he repeats right here, he repeats what he did, and then he takes this ungrouped, this ungrouped interval, and he groups it like this. And this is where the arithmetic gets very interesting, because you can consider this a grouping of two, and you can consider this a grouping of two. But if you look at these two black notes and this white one, what you have is the arithmetic 2 plus 1 equals 3. And so what he has is this, creating the third. And so far he went 1, 2, and then he took this grouping and laid it next to that grouping. But in doing that, the arithmetic 2 plus 1 came in, and which is coincidental, because the next thing he does in the piece is he repeats it, and he brings in the grouping of three. And so you see this process where there is an implied arithmetic, and then the next thing that happens is the actual arithmetic. Here, 2 plus 1 implies 3, and then he does, and actually brings it in to the piece in a grouping. So after this grouping, I'm just gonna represent it like this. After that grouping of 2 plus 1 equals 3, he creates this grouping, 3. And then what he does with the 3, it's right here. You have a grouping of 3, and then another grouping of 3 right here. But you'll notice that this tone right here, is common. There's an upward motion and there's a downward motion. And this tone is common to both contours. And so you have the arithmetic, the grouping of 3 plus 1 equals 4. And what you see happening in the piece next is groupings of 4. But what he does, and this is part of the process of the music, is it's a creation process in which you take an element and you start to generate new elements by it. So like the half step is used to create the third. The ungrouped fourth is used to create its complement. And since its complement is there, the fifth, then the ungrouped fourth becomes there. And then the addition of 2 plus 1 is used to create the grouping of 3. And what he does next is he overlaps this grouping of 3. He reuses it in a downward motion to create the grouping of 4. So now he's created all of these groupings. The next thing he does is fill in, he brings into the piece the actual scale by taking those groupings of 4 and laying them next to each other. But the groupings of 4 are done with a strange accent, because it starts on a weak beat. And so the way I'm hearing it is is really, I hear, a grouping of 3 plus 1. And so it's 3 plus 1, because it goes... And the next thing he does is he does a grouping of 4 that's accented, which is this. And then he does a grouping of 3, a grouping of 3, and a grouping of 2. And so what's going on in the piece is something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 8, 4, 3, 2, 1. And that is and that's going half step, third, fifth, sixth. And it's just following this beautiful pattern. And this third, if you take this third, for example, this is the beautiful thing about it. You start with this third and you lower the bottom tone and you create a dissonance which will resolve. And then the most imitative gesture to do next would be to reuse that half step, which brings this. And so no matter how you think about it, this figuration and this figuration are inherent in the possibilities, in the imitative nature of the scale. And so he takes this unit and he spreads it over time. And so what I did, I took the third and I lowered the bottom note to create that motion. If you do the reverse of that, you can raise the upper note and it creates a new dissonance. And so you can almost imagine Bach thinking something like this. And then spreading that over time. And then the rest of it is just filling out the symmetry. Because you can think of this piece as a proposition to convincingly produce motion from a third to its complement. And it seems that the way he does that is by using the information in these groupings and the imitative nature to build small units into larger units. So that everything that happens in the piece is directly derived from something else, which has a kind of nature of creation in it. And there's really a whole lot more to say about the piece, but because I want to leave time for questions, I'm going to stop there and ask if there are any questions. Please.
Could you play the melody one more?
Yeah. Curious, maybe by show of hands, can you hear 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. And the thing that is really interesting is that you might not hear the same groupings that I'm hearing. I might hear 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. But you could hear 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 2, 1, or something. And the arithmetic is kind of equivalent, it's overlapping on itself, which means that while you hear 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, this is still convincing us as one. And I'll just say, just anecdotally, he starts at this third and he moves to that sixth. The next phrase, he starts on a sixth that's created by this G and the note that's up here. He moves from a sixth to a third. And it's a little bit like this. Third, sixth. And then the next phrase is sixth to a third. And so this is what I was trying to get back at the beginning to try to get at, is that Bach is thinking in individual scale types. Formula types, and there's almost a geometry in how he says, make a piece that is exploring the third the number three, the third complement, and all of the different places in the scale that it exists. And the whole piece unfolds there, and so that's basically what I had to talk about today. So, any questions?
I had a question. So in that first grouping, that first possible grouping of three, you were saying that it is a grouping of two with an implied third, or a third that sort of arises out of it. Could you explain that?
Oh, yeah, okay. So this is the first grouping.
Yeah.
And so I was going to say, what numbers can you say are in that grouping? And I'm using the interval, which is a half step, which is the number two. I'm using the rhythm, which is three, and I'm using that there's only one stressed note, which is that note. And so you have the number one as a stressed note, the number two as the interval, the number three as the rhythm. Mm-hmm. And then you actually kind of have the number four if you were to consider the beat. And so that's where I was saying that was the first part of your question. And then the second part was, how does it create a third? Mm-hmm. This is a half step. Mm-hmm. So there's a G and an A flat. I guess you could see it here. This is a half step. Mm-hmm. And so take that information, and where else can you repeat that in the scale?
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yeah. Okay. Now that, so it sort of tells you where your possibilities are. You see, there's other pieces where he doesn't use that half step, he uses this one. He has a piece that goes. And he's using the other half step instead of the lower one. But, so what happens is you have this half step and that half step, right? Mm-hmm. And then you see how that is, because that's built into the scale. And so he's just using the scale as a paradigm for, let me do a grouping for one interval type. Now I'll use that grouping to repeat that interval type somewhere in the scale to generate a new interval. This grouping emphasized C. The second grouping, the stress note was A. And if you hold them, you can hear the third arises. You see that?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so that's how it goes in the piece. The structure of the piece is found through the notes that are emphasized.
So these numbers are appearing in, I guess, different levels of understanding.
Yeah.
Different layers of
different music. Perceptions, which is partly why music is such a subjective thing, I think. There is this kind of geometry and arithmetic that is within the scale, but it depends on our interaction with it. What aspect you emphasize in your own relationship to it. Mm-hmm. And so somebody might hear the accent and create that third, but somebody else might have heard just the half, the accent of just the use of the half step. And you can see how that would have just taken you. So it's about, oh, what do I notice? And then what do I see potentiality in? And in this way, melody can progress in this very deeply integrated process. And which is really kind of the underlying reason for the lecture, because I don't know how to say this, but I feel like there is this tension that exists. It's sort of epic in the way that it's eternal. You have this kind of arithmetic seeming very impersonal. We think this is Bach's genius. We also think, well, these intervals and these patterns are traced back to maybe the mathematics of Pythagoras. It's the same intervals that Plato discusses in the Timaeus. And so you get this sense in this kind of music when you listen to Bach that you can almost go as far as saying Bach is sort of suggesting the Platonic forms in his music. And puts a pressure maybe on composers, because you have this tension between the eternal, the general, and the particular, or the individual. you have this tension between the individual and the culture. How do you find your voice as a composer? When if you imitate or find the pure kind of arithmetic of it, you start to sound like someone else. And so these are really deep questions, I think, and I think it's really sort of beautiful to see underneath of it that there is an impersonal arithmetic that is both logical and geometric, but also not only does it allow, it actually requires for your own participation with it, for you to make a choice about it. And I think knowing how instead of trying to say the eternal or the individual, you can just look at the tension between them and understand how to develop a relationship between them. And I think understanding the arithmetic and then understanding how to make choices with it is the beginnings of forming a relationship to that tension.
Jason, do you think it's possible that Bach did an arithmetic composition first before melody and then fit the melody to the math?
It's possible, because these sorts of things align from different, it's sort of like where you have an X, Y axis and a Z axis. You can describe the same point in different ways, and so the arithmetic can be arrived at from different perspectives. So if he created some kind of math game, if the parameters in his game reflected the same parameters in the scale, then I can imagine how it would turn out a piece. Also, the interesting thing is, that's sort of the beautiful thing about his music, is you can project into it that he designed it this way, or that he just found patterns, and it's sort of that it kind of gets to the same, it comes to the same result. Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to ask, so if you were to try and imagine what this math game entails, how would you play it, the math game?
So the game that I imagine is not an external mathematics. And I think the question is, we hear Bach is math, Bach uses math. And I think maybe the first instinct is to think that there's a mathematics that's outside the music. Like, here's a mathematical game, now I'll apply it to sound. And I think what I'm observing is that the game is within the scale already. There's already half steps. This is a half step. This is a half step. That's a half step. You can form intervals by them. When you look back on the other side of the board where I had all the patterns, I think that's the mathematics is embodied in the different individual scale patterns. And so being able to recognize each grouping of two as its own individual, each grouping of three as its own individual, and to see how does each individual grouping generate all of the other groupings? So you have a set of elements, and any element can be used to generate all the other elements. And how to do that is found within the patterns of the scale, and where the individual intervals can be found and repeated. So that, I would think that's where the game is.
So just a two-part question, really, kind of related, but. Is it safe to assume that you recognize this pattern in all of Bach's music, his entire body of work? Like, does he have a free jazz album that, you know?
No, no free jazz album. Every piece that I've analyzed, I've pretty much analyzed all of the fugues and preludes in his first well-tempered clavier. I analyzed his Art of the Fugue, and then a number of fugues from his organ pieces. And also just from listening to it, I can hear the arithmetic. In fact, there's another lecture I want to give about it. There are propositions, construction postulates, that say because of these rules, there are certain patterns that will derive from them that always combine. They're sort of predicted from this, and those are the same patterns that you see in his music. So,
these patterns that you recognize in Bach, you recognize them in other composers, and where don't you recognize them? And
right.
Like a historical perspective.
Right, so that's a really interesting question, because I had a teacher who once said that you can learn about a composer not by how they follow the rules, but seeing how they break the rules. And the thing with Bach is, I think he's expressing such a I was going to use the word pure arithmetic, but what I think I mean is economical arithmetic, meaning if I'm going to go from here to here, what's the most economical way to get there? And that's what Bach is doing. And I think that's, how would you say, there's a quality in Bach that's very distinctive. We say that's especially Bach. And I talked to a scholar of Bach once, and he made this joke to me. He said, we have all of the conventions, all of the tools and techniques, we know what he did, but you take something that he harmonized, and you compare it to something a student harmonizes, or even a teacher harmonizes, and he says, Bach's is always better. And so the question is, why? And I think the question, I think the answer has to do with, are you bringing your individuality to it, or are you drawing out the potentialities of the arithmetic? And what Bach is doing is he's really combining consonant intervals into pathways. Here's a consonant interval, here's a consonant interval, there's a consonant interval, there's a consonant interval. He might do something like this. Difference in quality, I think it's the difference between relating to music at an emotional perceptual level, in which a contour, a melodic form can do any number of things according to your emotion or to your ideas about it. With Bach's music, I feel like it's always guided by the limited possibilities of that one particular individual type. I don't know if that answers you. Maybe he's expressing it in the most economic way, and maybe that's what's unique about him. That not everybody else is thinking about what's the most economic way to create that motion to that motion. Yeah.
Could you maybe, and if you don't have it at hand, that's absolutely fine, but show a way that another composer might sort of create that complementary third to sixth action.
Sure, let me just see if I could just make something up. It's gonna probably sound a little different.
Thanks.
you have a question?
No, no, no. I thought I saw you raising
your hand. Oh, no, I scratched my face.
All right.
Well, I'm good.
Okay. So,
Yeah, well, ask your question. I'll get back to this.
Okay. You're highlighting, I think, a merit of Bach's, right, which is that he's got this commitment to parsimony, and that you could also understand that as him letting the music kind of speak, or him letting the relationship speak, rather than Bach speak.
Okay.
Is that right? Okay.
I guess you could say it that way.
Now, on Mr. Petrowski's question, does that make him the pinnacle of music, you see, or is that still a subjective question? Because I could say, well, what if Euclid really is the pinnacle of geometry, and that Bertrand Russell critiques him for not being parsimonious, because Euclid has some couple extra things that end up having applications later, so that extra can be then celebrated in a way. So what you did that was meandering could be celebrated in a way, even though it's not coming from the arithmetic. You get my question?
Yeah, so I'll answer yours, and then I'll get back to your question.
Sorry.
No, it's a good question. I think with that question, it's important to say that what music is a, perhaps a different question than what Bach's music is. And music inevitably, and perhaps necessarily, gets into culture and psychology. And so that it's hard to. I think the way I would probably say is to go back to this idea that of epics, like the Iliad or the Odyssey or something, or where you have something that's deathless, it's eternal, and that what's really happening in music history is these eternal things are perpetuating, and with something like Bach, you could say, well, this is a tension, I'm just going to repeat myself a little, this is a tension that exists between the individual and the culture, between the particular and the general, between the eternal and the ephemera. And I think Bach's music is so, in a way, so persistent because it embodies one aspect of that tension, which is it seems to embody something that we call eternal, we feel a sense of eternity through the music. One of my projects is to be able to separate the profoundness of eternity from the sound of his music. It is to say that his music sounds this way because of this really, in a way, mundane arithmetic. There's patterns, and you can play those patterns, and it creates that sound. It's just a mathematical character of the scale to produce those sounds. You can just sit down and you can learn to do those, and you can just freely maneuver through the scale and sound like Bach. So the sound of Bach isn't profound. Perhaps, why does that sound make us feel eternity? Is maybe a more profound question. And I think that the tension is Bach is embodying this eternity, whereas then you have individual artists who are not emphasizing the economy between notes. Their music is coming from a different place. Their music might be there to move the body instead of move the soul. You know? And so, I don't know if that answered your question.
You addressed that, thank you.
Yeah, and now, can we get back to your question, Lewis?
Well, I was just going to ask about the relationship between establishing intervals, given the limitation of the scale, and how specifically, but how the composer decides on the rhythms and the repetitions. So, like, how does Bach decide on not just emphasizing that part of the da na na, but going da na na with the other note, and then da da with the other notes?
So, there's a term for this. I think it's I think the term is growing probability geometry. I don't know if that's quite how to phrase it, but in any grouping. If you're using the scale as the paradigm, then if you do a grouping, your highest probability is the same interval. And when you repeat that interval, you will create a new element, like we showed in Bach. And so I think what happens is it's not about how do I determine. It's not that kind of question. It's more about what possibility do I see here.
Right.
And then making a choice to flesh that possibility out. With Bach, there's something profound happening because he's expressing the symmetrical character of the scale. And so, for your question, the answer would be what you want to do is learn individual, you can call them propositions, individual expressions of the scale. To go from a third to a sixth, to go, you know, to play this part of the fifth and then to play that part of the fifth. Just in learning how to identify individual aspects of the scale and learning how to identify what are the pathways of symmetry that exist around it, and then learning to say, I will now express this pathway, and what are the ways that I can do it? So that ends up becoming a lifelong study. And to that, I recommend learning to analyze Bach. Were there other questions? No other questions? Going once? Okay. So then that brings us to a close. Thank you very much for coming, and look forward to giving more lectures, and hopefully there will be more GI lectures in the future. So, yeah, thank you.